Today is the problem with kinfolk. Mm-hmm. You remember when we did the problem with church folk? Mm-hmm. Okay, our spiritual walk is going to be greatly challenged by the environment in which we find ourselves. Amen. Remember now, when God called Abraham, he called him out of Ur of the Chaldees, and he said, Abraham, I need you to go away from your family so you can meet your destiny, because your destiny is not going to be around here where your family is. Amen. So you got to go. Now, God is the one who designed family, but he also knows that family can be an obstacle to our spiritual growth. If our relationship with our family is not healthy, there's some toxic relationship that can inhibit our spiritual growth, and we need to be aware of those things. We need to be aware of those dynamics so that we can get to where God want to bring us. Somebody help me right here. So the problem with kinfolk, it got to be preached. It's sitting right there on the text. I could have skipped it and went to chapter 4, but the Holy Spirit put it right there, so it needed to be preached. You know, so we find Jesus, and you got to remember now, these are the four, his brothers and sisters. Now, we all know about Jesus and Mary and Joseph. At this time, Jesus is about 27 years old. Joseph is dead. He got brothers and sisters. Imagine, now this is the sinless Son of God. And y'all need to get this. Imagine now, you grew up with a household of children. Anybody that got more than two children know what I'm talking about. You got a house full. And one of them is sinless. Come on. Do you know how hard it is? Imagine now, you got a bunch of children in your house. Y'all know children can be bad. And you got one that's good. I mean, we're talking perfect. And the rest of them a bunch of babies. Could you imagine how much heck he gonna catch from them babies? Every time they do something, my mama ask, who broke my cup? He can't lie. See, we had this deal going up when we were growing up in my Maggie's house. Now, she could read minds. And you know, you can lie to her and she just... She could read minds. I'm convinced Maggie could read minds. But we had this deal going on that nobody tell. Did nobody tell? I don't care what happened. Did nobody tell? We already decided beforehand whatever happened, we wasn't gonna tell. Now I'm gonna tell you what would happen. My older sister Jackie would blackmail us. That's what kind of, you know. Your grandmama, she used to blackmail us, Deloria. So you know we done something. Jackie just holding it over us, and we end up having to wash dishes when it ain't our turn, all kinds of stuff. She wasn't them kind of Negro. But imagine growing up with somebody that don't do nothing wrong. Now I was a smart addict. I was, you know, real smart, and you know, I was one of them kids that there's a question I could always knew the answer. I was that one. But I still bad as hell. You know, everybody ever watched The Big Bang Theory and Young Sheldon? Remember how Young Sheldon in high school at 10. Well, I wasn't in high school at 10, but the contrast with academic abilities was almost as profound at times. So you got the smart aleck, but I was bad. So, but you got one like Jesus that knows all the answers, and you got to grow up with him. And then when he start preaching, his ministry, his public ministry starts, and he's made this declaration that he is the Son of God, what his family going to be? Now, his mama know the truth. His mama know that Mary knew that what he was saying was the absolute truth. She's known that before he was born, who he was, who he would become, who he was. She knew his destiny. But nobody else did. And she had to keep that to herself. In fact, when at the wedding at Cana, when they ran out of wine, and this was a big tragedy, they ran out of wine at a wedding. This just didn't happen in those days, in that culture. And they came to Mary and said, "We done ran out of wine." And Mary said, "Go to Jesus, go to my son, and whatever he tell you to do, that's what you do." Now, at this time, Jesus' public ministry hadn't started, but once Jesus started doing miracles, he couldn't stop. The messianic clock engages. And when Mary asked Jesus, "Look, Jesus, you need to take care of this." And Jesus said, "Are you sure you want me to do this, woman? Because once I start on this road, ain't no turning back. Because once the clock starts, then the cross is looming. Once Jesus makes the declaration that I am the Son of God, that I am the Messiah, that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to bind the wounds of the brokenhearted, once he makes that declaration, you cannot unring that bell. You see, you want me to start on this journey right now." You're dealing with kinfolk now. His mother was the only one that knew the truth. Everybody else thought it was crazy. So when the word got out that Jesus done gone and lost his mind, the family shows up amongst this crowd. I'm trying to set this up. I want you to understand what's happening. So the family shows up. Their intention really is to do an intervention. That's what the brothers and sisters thinking. Mary came really just to kind of make sure that they don't get, because she knew what was going to happen. She wanted to be there to be not only a witness and can maybe kind of stir them in the right direction so they can get the right idea, so they can understand the truth of what was really about to happen with their older brother. They came for an intervention because they heard that these folks were going to try to kill him. So Jesus, you need to come with us because it's some folk who trying to kill you. You done lost your mind. So come on with us and we just going to kind of get you out of trouble. But Jesus, looking at them like they had their minds. That's something to stop. They came for an intervention. Mm-hmm. And they didn't understand. Let me tell you something. When you do ministry, one of the first things you need to understand, kinfolk may reject your ministry.